Welcome to the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility, an ongoing inquiry into American political origins and evolving institutions. The Executive Director of the Virtual Center is Dr. Bill Obrien. He's also your host for this continuing conversation. Here he is now, Dr. Bill Obrien.
Well, thank you, Agnes, and welcome to this beautiful Monday in the last week of April. Today is the 29th day of April in the year 2019. It is a pleasure to be with you today. It is absolutely gorgeous outside today, I do believe. And I know that there's been some really rocky, difficult weather. I know that a major storm went up the coast this weekend and was pounding the area with heavy rain and all the way up into New England. And so everybody's not having the kind of nice weather that we've got right now. But on the other hand, we've had our share also. So I feel like we've got this coming to us. Welcome to this new week of broadcasting here at the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. It is a pleasure to be with you. I would love to hear from you. In fact, Agnes made a comment when we were chatting before we came on the air that there's so much going on out there that, it's hard to know where to start. I mean, it really is. And I guess the best place is to make the point, as we usually do make at this point at the beginning of the program, that the best place to begin is with the priority that we place on you, the listener. This program is about you. And consequently, we want you to know that we do welcome you to participate actively in this program by coming on the air and sharing your thoughts or concerns with us. There's so much going on out there. We all have opinions. We all have concerns. We all have hopes. We're all, kind of budding with anticipation about things that might happen or have happened or will happen or whatever. We would love for you to share your thoughts on these things with us. And for that purpose, we have a toll-free number that will give you an opportunity to come on the air almost immediately. It's an 844 number, and it's toll-free. And it'll get you directly into the studios, and Agnes is there, and she'll get you on the air immediately if you call. The number is one – well, you don't need a one if you're dialing with a cell phone, as you know, but if you're using a landline, you do. So it's 1-844-843-4676. That's 1-844-THE-HORN. And 843-4676 translates into the horn. And so if you dial that number, again, Agnes will get you on the air immediately. We would love to hear from you. Please understand that at any time during the program, if you are inclined to call in, please don't let what the topic is or what I'm talking about deter you from calling in. I know I've talked to some people who say, well, there's a couple of times I was going to call in, but you were right in the middle of something and I didn't want to interrupt. And I said, look, it's not an interruption. The program is about you. So if you call, believe me, we want to hear what you've got to say. If you'd like to share your thoughts with me, either in an email or in a comment through our Facebook page, that's a good way to communicate as well. We would love you to react to the program in whatever way you feel most comfortable. If it's an email, if you'd like to send an email to me, my email address is waobrien906@gmail.com. That's waobrien, O-B-R-I-E-N, 906@gmail.com. Another way that you can comment to me is through our Facebook page. If you go to our Facebook page, just go to the homepage, facebook.com, and you'll see a search box at the top. And if you type into that box the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution, you'll be onto our Facebook page and you'll see a number of postings there. I put one on there yesterday, I believe, and maybe it was Saturday. And it's something that I'm going to be dealing with in the program today. But you can get the posting that I put on there. What I'm going to deal with today is not necessarily what's in that posting. Some of it is, but some of it's not. I guess what I say, what I'm saying is, it's one of those. The issue at hand is that I have in mind is, it's one of those things that every time you read it, you see something else, if you know what I mean. And so I put the posting on Facebook, and then I keep looking at the document. I keep finding more, and I said, maybe I moved a little bit too fast on the posting. But be that as it may, it's there. The point is, there are a number of other postings there as well. And at the end of every one of these postings, there are two buttons or two links, a share link and a comment link. If you click on the share link, it sends that particular posting to all your friends on your Facebook account. So that gives us wider exposure. And of course, that helps us and hopefully them. So you know, we encourage you and thank you if you choose to do that. On the other hand, if you click on the comment button, it'll give you an opportunity to direct the comment back to me directly. It can either be about, it can be about that posting, but it doesn't necessarily have to be. The presumption on Facebook is, of course, that it will be, that you when you comment at the end of a posting, then what you're commenting about will be that based on that posting. That's the idea, but on the other hand, it's not a hard and fast rule. If you've got a comment that you'd like to make about the program or about issues that we've covered on the program or not covered or didn't do as well a job covering them as you believe, and if you're on Facebook anyway, then it might be more convenient for you to make your comment that way than to send an email. But the fastest, most direct way, of course, is to pick up the phone and use the 844 toll-free number and come on the air and make your point yourself. All I want you to know is that you are welcome. You are not in any way ever would be interfering. What I've got, I can do later. I can do another day. I would tell you that we're at the end of the second month of our seventh year. So, pending some sort of a disaster on my end, then we're going to be here. And what I don't cover today, I'll have a chance to cover tomorrow. So don't feel that you're interrupting anything or whatever. It may befuddle me for a few minutes because it kind of changes my train of thought in the middle. It may take me a little bit of time to get back to it. But that doesn't take precedence over your access to this program. And I want you to know that you're always invited to do it, and you're thanked for it even ahead of time. So please be advised. We would love to hear from you. As I mentioned in the chatting conversation I had with Agnes, there's an awful lot going on out there. There's an awful lot that's happened. In fact, one of the pieces, issues that I want to deal with right at the outset of the, you know, close to the beginning of the program today, is kind of a list of some of the things that have happened. I think you'll appreciate it. I did, and I just wanted to share it with you. But as you know, Joe Biden has entered the race formally, officially, and he's, I believe there are 17 announced candidates. He comes into the race as the favorite in the polls. That could change. We don't know. He also raised a record amount of money right after he opposed. I think in the first 24 hours, he was in excess of $6 million or something like that. kind of like Pete Buttigieg, who really raised a lot of money after he announced as well. And so he is in the race, and there's still a lot of conversation about whether he should have run. I heard a lot of people. In fact, I kind of lean this way myself. I think I wish that he hadn't done this. It's not that I don't like him. I like him a lot. I don't think there's too many people that don't like Joe Biden. But he has a long track record. He's been in politics for years. He's done some things that he wouldn't do now. He's admitted that. He's apologized for things that he did and didn't apologize up until now. He's kind of done that. He issued kind of an offhanded, backhanded comment, apology to Anita Hill, because he chaired the Senate committee before which she appeared in the confirmation hearing for Clarence Thomas some years ago. The president apologized for the way that she was treated, but he did it in the past tense. In other words, it's a little bit standoffish as far as apologies go. There's nothing in there that says, I'm sorry for the way that I, as chairman of that committee, treated you. Instead, what he's saying is, on behalf of all the people on that committee, I want to apologize for the way you were treated. There's a difference. And so some people have concerns about that. On the other hand, we are in a 24/7 news cycle, as we know. There are any number of outlets, media outlets now. So consequently, there are so many institutions, groups, and agencies that are combing over everything that you've ever done or said, then having an extensive experience, track record in politics exposes you to any number of things that you may have even forgotten happened to you or were done by you or something like that. So there are many people, and I do like Joe Biden, and I think he has a lot to say, and I think he has a lot to offer. On the other hand, I think there comes a time when you got to pass the baton to somebody else. I did that. I mean, I had to do that. I had to face facts. I ran for election and didn't make it in 2016. And a number of people who did support me has asked if I intended to run again in 2018. And I said no. And it just seems to me that it's really time to, you know, I felt it was time to move out of the way and give somebody else a chance. I kind of believe that philosophically. In Joe Biden's case, he's already experienced so much tragedy in his life that I don't think, and you know, that if he doesn't win, he stays in the race and doesn't win, it's going to be yet another painful experience. And I don't know whether, in fact, he needs that. But he did it. He's got a lot of people that support him. And I think if it comes down to that, I would as well. But I guess I like him too much. It was kind of like John McCain. John McCain was a Republican, and I disagree with him on a lot of things. But as I mentioned at the time he passed away, I had a lot of admiration, a lot of respect for him in a lot of ways. And so anyway, that's one thing that occurred over the, you know, since we've been together. The other thing, another thing that has happened, which I think is very important, is that the president has really doubled down on his determination to not cooperate with the Democratic-controlled House of Representatives. He's flirting, and every all the media people are saying this, he's flirting with constitutional crisis. He's creating a situation where, you know, and I've heard some people say the constitutional crisis isn't in the, in, possibly in the future, it's here. But the point is, and I think I put this on Facebook, he's pretty much making moves that fly in the face of separation of powers in a lot of different ways. He's done it in a lot of different ways. And this is one, urging his people not to respond to subpoenas is really putting Congress in a position where they're going to have to do something else. Because if he gets away with ignoring or resisting subpoenas, then that is setting a precedent which would be much worse than the experience of trying to back up the subpoena forcefully. So the threats are getting more and more serious, and the danger, it seems to me, to the system itself is becoming greater and greater. So I do believe. And also, the tone on the Mueller report, which has now been out for a while, the tone on the Mueller report from the president is changing as well. He obviously is engaged in a very potentially shrewd strategy to attack that program, that report. And I really do believe that there's a serious issue there. And I think this might be a good time to share with you the piece that I was referring to earlier. I happen to see this piece. It's a piece written, put together by a gentleman named Robert Freeman. It appeared in Common Dreams, and it's dated April 28th, so it's dated yesterday. And it's a list, it's entitled to be 30 specific reasons why Donald Trump represents the worst in America's political system. And the reason I mention it is not because the argument by the author is made so much, but what Freeman does is compile item after item, issue after issue, that makes the case to support his title of Donald Trump being America's worst, if you will. And each of these, and there are 30 of them, each of these begins with the phrase, it's bad enough that. It's bad enough that this happened. It's bad enough that that happened. It's bad enough that this happened. I wanted to share quickly. Most of these you've heard of. Many of them we've talked about here on the program. But there have been so many instances that it's only when you see a compilation of these things all put together in one place that you begin to appreciate the immensity of the threat that we face. So let me share this with you, and I think you'll understand what I mean. Remember, at the beginning of every one of these, it's bad enough that, it's bad enough that. All right, the first one, it's bad enough that he lost the election by 3 million popular votes. Bad enough that he helped the Russians do that. That he helped the Russians by providing them confidential polling data to guide Russians' Facebook targeting of ads. Bad enough that the Russians helped get him elected. by manipulating social media in critical states. We talked about that the other day. It's bad enough that those ads were seen by more than 100,000 people when the electoral, when the difference in three states total was only 70,000 votes. Think about that. Bad enough that those involved in the campaign who were directly engaged with the Russians lied repeatedly, publicly and under oath, about that engagement with the Russians. Bad enough that tens of millions of dollars mysteriously disappeared from the president's inauguration committee, and he doesn't seem to feel any need to explain where it went. Bad enough that he brags about groping women. Bad enough that he's been accused of sexual assault by more than 20 different women. Bad enough that he's an unindicted co-conspirator in the felony to commit election fraud, finance fraud, by paying hush money to a Playboy bunny and to a porn star. Bad enough that he filed for bankruptcy six times, thereby stiffing his own workers, contractors, and those who lent him money, tens of millions of dollars of money. Bad enough that at his resorts and other properties, for years, he's regularly hired undocumented aliens, even as he rails against the tidal wave of illegal immigrants. Bad enough that he inherited $413 million from his father, much of it through illegal tax dodges, while he pretends to be self-made. Bad enough that his personal charitable foundation was forced to shut down after having revealed to have been a sham, principally designed to promote his own business and political interests. Bad enough that he continues to insist that he was a wonderful student, yet threatens to sue any institution that releases his grades or his transcripts. Bad enough that he claims to be a brilliant businessman, yet refuses to release his taxes, which would indeed prove that he is a brilliant businessman or that he isn't. Bad enough that he says that the Mueller report totally exonerates him. When we know it doesn't. Bad enough that he underestimated the value of his assets in order to dodge taxes. Bad enough that the Mueller report detailed 10 instances of potential obstruction of justice. And just today, former prosecutor Sally Yates made the comment that if he wasn't president, he would be indicted for obstruction of justice. Bad enough that he's a pathological liar, telling somewhere in the neighborhood of 10,000 lies since assuming office. Bad enough that he sucked up to Vladimir Putin and said that he believed Putin on Russian interference in the 26 elections over his own intelligence heads. Bad enough that he separated thousands of immigrant children from their parents, put them in cages, and then lost track of them. Bad enough that he praised white supremacist neo-Nazi marchers in Charlottesville, and then just a few days ago defended his remarks again. Bad enough that though he took an oath that the laws would be faithfully executed, He's told his own immigration officials to break the law and promises to pardon them if they were convicted of doing that. Bad enough that he told senior White House aides to lie to the Mueller Commission about his efforts to obstruct that same commission's investigation. Bad enough that he smeared a Gold Star family. Bad enough that he smeared a bona fide Vietnam War hero, John McCain. Bad enough that he promised to help the working man and then immediately passed a $1.5 trillion tax cut that went mostly to corporations and the wealthy. Bad enough that he continued to claim he's building the wall when not a single inch of new wall has been built since he took office. Bad enough that he promised senior citizens to protect Social Security and only 2 weeks ago submitted a budget that cuts benefits to millions, including seniors. Bad enough that he refuses to cooperate with congressional hearings, trashing the Constitution and the checks and balances at the heart of our form of government. Those are the 30. There are obviously more than that. But when you see them all in one place, it's overwhelming, it seems to me. So the issue of the article is not the point of the article, it seems to me, is not how many more there are. To tolerate this, dividing us against each other, threatening our values, degrading our civic spaces, destroying our institutions. When does it go bad enough that we the people choose to do something? When does it get bad enough that Republican leaders are finally willing to stand up and support the oath of office that they took? It seems to me that when, and this is just common sense, when you pile up that many pieces of evidence in one place, and then you ask the right kind of questions at the end of it, when is enough enough? The unfortunate answer that you have to think about is maybe it'll never be enough. Maybe people are so used to looking the other way and finding and cherry picking positives in order to blunt the negatives, drive them into the background, that they'll never be enough. The reason I wanted to mention this is because I read a piece yesterday that I think this is good background for, because it raises questions that this particular piece addresses. I wanted to share it with you because I think it provides some really powerful insights into some of the issues and some of the choices that we all face politically. Just yesterday, there was an article published, dated yesterday, based on a paper written by Elizabeth Bobrick. Elizabeth Bobrick is a visiting scholar in classical studies at Wesleyan University. And what she does is consider the Greek tragedy Antigone as a way to look at some of the things and some of the choices that we face today. I've read Antigone. I've spoken about it and written about it several times, although it's been more than a couple of years since I've done that. But I never really thought about applying applying Antigone to today's political situation. But this particular scholar does. And I made the decision that this is something that all people listening to this program, I think, would appreciate, whether you're familiar with Antigone or not. The article summarizes the tragedy. It was written in the 5th century by Sophocles, and it basically deals with three teenagers who are struggling with a question that seems pertinent right now. What happens when a ruler declares that those who resist his dictates are enemies of the state and enemies to the people? And that ruler has almost or close to as many supporters as he has detractors. What happens? The author points out that Greek tragedy is always mythology. And a principal benefit or value of mythology is that it gives us safe space. You can look at contemporary problems without getting into political priorities and affiliations today. In other words, you can take the situation from Greek mythology and apply it to contemporary affairs today with very positive benefits. And that's what this author demonstrates, that visiting for the first time Sophocles' Antigone does. I think it's a pretty powerful lesson and a pretty poignant exercise. So let's look at the play. The play is called Antigone because the heroine in the play is Antigone. And it basically mirrors the situation we're going in today. First, a summary of the play. It begins just after the end of a civil war and it's set in Thebes, in the royal household of Thebes. Oedipus, the Greek king, is Antigone's father, as well as the father of two sons, Eteocles and Polynices. So Antigone, Eteocles, and Polynices are siblings, sister and brothers. After Oedipus is banned from Thebes, Antigone's two brothers, Eteocles and Polynices, are expected to share the kingship. But no sooner does this begin than Eteocles exiles Polynices and declares himself sole ruler. on his deathbed, Oedipus curses both sons and prophesies that they will die at each other's hands. That, in other words, as punishment for what the two of them have done, they will end up taking each other's life. Polynices returns after being banished with a band of followers. Eteocles fights him with the city's army. And just as the father predicts, the brothers died at each other's hands. Polynices' allies are driven away, and his corpse lies outside the walls of the city. With both heirs to the throne dead, both brothers dead, their uncle, Creon, declares himself king. And indeed, he was next in line to be crowned king. When he declares himself king, he issues a decree. And that decree is, no one is to perform funeral rites for Polynices because he was a traitor. His body is to be left rotting in the sun, preyed upon by vultures. Anyone caught trying to bury him will be executed. Some explanation, and this is the author speaking. To refuse burial rites to traitors happened. That's not something that never happened before. But when the body involved is your own relative, that creates a different situation. As the head of the family, Creon was obliged by religion, by custom, to make sure his nephew was buried. But as king, over in the large context of the country that he headed, he could refuse those rights to a traitor, which is what he chose to do. At this point, Antigone enters the picture. She immediately rushes to tell her sister, Ismene, the news, certain that Ismene will join her in disobeying the decree because the gods are offended by a body that is not buried. Without proper burial, their two brothers could not enter the underworld. Their spirits could not enter the next life, the underworld. Polynices is their brother, traitor or not, Antigone believes. Ismene begs her not to defy her uncle, the king. We're just girls. We'll die if we do this. Antigone immediately erupts at her sister, tells her that she hates her, and rushes off to carry out the plan herself. Her intent is to go find the body, cover it with a few handfuls of dirt, which was really the one best thing that she could do. When Creon found out what Antigone was doing, he had her brought before him and declares that Antigone must die. She remains defiant and scornful. The more she does that, the more angry Crayon becomes, the more determined he becomes to carry out her execution. His own son is Antigone's fiancé, Haman. He tries to intercede with his father on Antigone's behalf. And Crayon, at this point, is so angry he refuses to listen. Crayon orders that Antigone should be taken to a cave and left to starve. She's led away. And then Crayon gets word from a prophet that the gods will punish him for putting a living soul underground and keeping a dead body above ground. Crayon dismisses the prophecy, but is persuaded by citizens to go save Antigone and bury Polynices. Crayon rushes to her tomb, but it's too late. He finds two dead bodies there. Antigone has hanged herself. Crayon's son, Haman, has fallen on his sword in grief. And when Crayon's own wife, Haman's mother, hears the news of her son's death, she also kills herself. At this point, Crayon loses it. "Lead me away," he says. "I'm worse than useless. I am impious." Crayon went from defending the civil order that he headed, saying that traitors must be punished. Those who show any love for them are traitors also. Yet his principles lead to the deaths of many, including his own son. Haman, in this story, is the moderate. He and his fiance, Ismene, he and Ismene try to persuade Antigone and Crayon both to drop their intransigence toward each other. Every character in this play was forced to take a position, make a choice between good and evil. It's impossible for any character in this story to remain a moderate, to remain in the middle. The situation forces every one of them to the extreme. They have to take one side or the other. There's no such thing here as being neutral. And here's the kicker. What's the message from this story that all of us can take away? According to the author, they are these. When fellow citizens become enemies, their bonds of family and friendship are weakened, eventually destroyed. When primary identity is reduced to us versus them, the definition of justice closes, and it simply becomes what helps us harms them. In other words, the whole situation deteriorates into what we call tribalism. When fellow citizens become enemies, the bonds that held them together as family or friends is weakened, as everybody is forced to take one side or the other. When a leader urges citizens to identify his enemies as enemies of the state or enemies of the people, what the citizens end up having most in common is anger, fear, and mutual contempt. In other words, you are forcing citizens to make the same kinds of difficult choice. When you consider the moderates in this story, Ismaney and Haman, what you see is that those who try to dissuade others from actions that are rash. Thucydides, the Greek historian, made the comment that when a community is at war with itself, it's the moderates who suffer most because they're subject to attack by both sides. Also, a message from Antigone. A single person in power, if he is able to persuade or frighten enough people, can cause the suffering of innocents, the destruction of institutions and customs, the very things that hold the civic order together. I think that the situation here that we see in Antigone is pretty clearly a situation that we can apply to today's political environment. The same principles apply. I think the author is correct. I think the analogy between this Greek tragedy and today's political environment is a valid one. And that's the reason I wanted to share it with you. It's a tremendous exercise. You take a story which doesn't really take all that long to explain for people that hadn't heard it before. And you begin to see the difficult choices that the main characters in this play are forced to make. And then you look at the situation today in that long list of 30 items that we looked at, that the president has been guilty of. It's not an exhaustive list, obviously. It's not a complete list. But you find evidences of our president issuing decrees, like declaring a national emergency at the border when there's serious question as to whether there's any emergency at all. But in taking action to support the decree that there is a national emergency there, you create the national emergency by bringing troops to the border, by separating children from families, by locking them up in cage-like environments, or moving them far away to the point that people will not be able to find them, and you yourself, as the government, lose track of them. You feel no responsibility to bring these families back together again. You are, in a sense, creating the very emergency that you declared existed before it did. That's very much the situation that Creon's decree denying Polynices the right to a burial creates for every character in this play. and it produces deaths for all around Crayon. And suddenly, he is faced with the overwhelming reality that the people he loved most are dead, and he caused it. That's the part that I'm doubtful we're going to see. Because I don't think that degree of self-reflection is evident anywhere in our political environment today. The latest episode that seems to me to demonstrate this very idea, this very principle, is the expected testimony of the Attorney General William Barr this week before the House and Senate Judiciary Committees. The Senate on Wednesday, the House on Thursday. Because William Barr has objected to the way that the House Judiciary Committee under Jerry Nadler plans to do business. There was an intention on the, in the committee to permit staff, attorneys, to ask questions of William Barr as well as the members of the committee themselves. Barr has said he will not respond to that. And he's threatening to boycott his appearance. He will be going before the Senate committee the day before, Wednesday, day after tomorrow. But being a Senate committee, it's in control, it's under the leadership of Republicans, specifically Lindsey Graham. So the anticipation is that Barr is not going to get nearly the treatment from the Senate Judiciary Committee that he might get from the Democratic-controlled House Committee the next day. So Barr has taken it upon himself to begin to dictate the rules governing the way the committee operates, which puts members of the committee under the gun because they don't want to set that kind of precedent. The person called to testify spells out the rules under which he will testify. It's very interesting. That's pretty much what President Trump did in the Mueller investigation. At first, he openly acknowledged that he couldn't wait to testify because he didn't have anything to hide. And then his legal advisors finally persuaded him that they weren't comfortable letting him go personally before the Mueller investigators, because honestly, this president can't tell the truth. And chances are that he'll say something which will contradict something else that he said or did, and come out of that experience guilty of perjury. So rather than risk that, they were able to persuade the president not to go, to request the questions in writing. And as we know, the president responded to those questions in writing. And I think realistically, we know that he didn't answer them himself. His advisors did, his staff did, his attorneys did. But when asked that question by the media, you may recall that he asserted that he was the one that answered all the questions, that his advisors were there for backup, but he was the one that wrote the answers. Now that the Mueller report is out, we find out that there are somewhere in the neighborhood of 30 situations in the president's written responses to the Mueller committee, where the president claims he couldn't remember. This from the person who told the media on another occasion that he has a fabulous memory, one of the strongest in the world. And so it's clear that the Mueller report is not happy, not comfortable with the president's written answers. So the committee deferred, the investigators deferred, by allowing the president to submit written answers, and then many of them he didn't answer. So in effect, we never found out about the investigation's potential to subpoena the president of the United States to come before it. But it's very clear that it's very likely that if the Mueller group had subpoenaed the president, he wouldn't have responded. That he would have basically taken the issue to the courts. And that's effectively what he's telling his advisors and staff now. He basically says, we're going to reject, not pay attention to any of the subpoenas. We're going to fight them all. So what that is doing is creating an environment which will bring the courts into the picture. The president the other day made the comment that he's ready to go to the Supreme Court. And this may be the most frightening aspect of this whole story, because he believes that the court is so political that the majority will support him. He believes that he controls the court and that he can predict what the court will do. He made reference, if you'll recall, to the fact that the Supreme Court has Obama judges on it. And the Chief Justice, John Roberts, quickly responded to the president and said there are no Obama judges and Trump judges on the Supreme Court. They were just legal experts, professionals, given a job to do and working hard to do it in the best way they can. And the president's response to Roberts, sorry to disagree with you, but you do have Obama judges on that court. But I'm here to make sure that they are never again the majority. And with Gorsuch and Kavanaugh, the president believes he's done that. The lead story on Saturday, I believe, in the Washington Post focused on this particular issue and made the point, and I think that's why I'm mentioning this, because I think the point is well made. The fact that the president believes that the court has become so political that it's no longer a professional, unbiased legal body that the Constitution defines it to be, may be the most frightening part of this, part of all of it. Not only do we have the president denying subpoenas from Congress and denying Congress its legitimate authority for oversight of the executive branch. Now we have a president who believes that he's comfortably in control of the legal branch, the judicial branch. Not only that, but the other day when he mentioned this, he basically said that if reelected, he's liable to have the chance to appoint one or two additional justices to the Supreme Court, which will solidify the conservative majority even more. It's the fact that the president believes that he has successfully politicized the court on the excuse that it was already politicized and he was just politicizing it the other way. It's the fact that he believed that he has been able to do it and did it that is the most frightening of all. Because there are only three branches of government: executive, legislative, and judicial. And what we're seeing is that the executive branch believes it already has or needs to have control over both of those other branches, which totally violates the structure of government that the Constitution of the United States creates. That's where I believe we are. When we come back, we're going to pause and take our break. We're a few minutes over past the top of the hour. I want to pursue this issue a little bit further by looking at Federalist 65, which is Alexander Hamilton's paper, in which he lays out the Senate's role as decision maker in the issue of impeachment. Why the founders, the convention, the framers, didn't pick the Supreme Court to hear impeachments? Why was the Senate the ideal place to go in the issue of impeachment? It seems to me that this is important. And one of the things that makes it important is that the president immediately says he's going to go to the courts. Federalist number 65 makes very clear that the courts are not involved in the issue of impeachment at all, except for the fact that the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court presides over the Senate in an impeachment hearing. So when we come back and get into our second hour, I want to take a closer look at Federalist 65 and Hamilton's explanation of the rationale for this particular part of the Constitution of the United States. You're listening to the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. We are, it appears, 4 minutes after the top of the hour. We're going to take a break for 5 minutes, and then we'll be right back with our second hour. So I hope that you'll stay with us. Thank you.
return to the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. Here's your host, Dr. Bill O'Brien.
Thank you, Agnes. And I think I scared Agnes a little bit. I accidentally signed off from our connection on Skype in the middle. I was playing around with the computer. And
that's okay. I'm watching.
when somebody doesn't know what they're doing, plays around, it gets dangerous.
But we got each other's back, so that's
good. Oh, anyway, I apologize for that. Welcome to this, our second hour here on this Monday edition of the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. It's about 10 minutes after the hour, so we've got the better part of an hour to go. And for those of you just joining us, welcome to the program. For those of you who've been with us, thank you so much for sticking with us. We appreciate that. For those just joining us, we spent the first hour, other than touching on a few political issues of the day, of course, we spent some time with William Barr, and we spent time with a piece which listed 30 of the major concerns or offenses that many people believe the president has committed or continues to commit while he's in office. And then we looked at an article that appeared in yesterday's, I believe it was the New York Times. It was either the New York Times or the Washington Post. I didn't write down which. But there was an article in there by a visiting scholar at Wesleyan University, whose last name is Bulbrick, who did a masterful job, I think, with Sophocles' Antigone by, first of all, summarizing the outlining the story of the Antigone with us, and then basically drawing from it principles that apply to our political world today, namely what's going on in Washington. And I think it was a masterful job. It was perceptive. It was well put together, as well thought out. And we spent the best part of our first hour on that particular issue. And I, you know, if you didn't happen to hear the first hour, then I would really encourage you to go back to the Times and look at the April 28th edition of the Times, and I think you'll find the article on Antigone and what it has to teach us about today's political world. And at the end of the hour, if you'll recall, we were talking about William Barr's refusal to or potential, he hasn't refused yet. He has threatened to refuse to appear before the House Judiciary Committee this Thursday, as he is scheduled to do, insisting that he was invited to answer questions by members of the committee, not attorneys that are on their staffs. And the fact of the matter is, there's precedence for this. I think I didn't mention this in our first hour, but during the break, it occurred to me. If you remember not too long ago, during the Kavanaugh confirmation hearings, when the professor in California came before the court to make her came before Congress to make her case, the Senate, actually it was the Senate Judiciary Committee, because it was a confirmation hearing for Justice Kavanaugh. But the woman, Blasey Ford, if you remember, who accused Kavanaugh of sexual abuse years ago, came before the committee and was questioned by members of the Republican majority staff. You may also remember that Hillary Clinton appeared on the Benghazi situation for several hours of testimony. I think it was like 11 hours or something like that during the investigation of the Benghazi incident. And questions then were asked by staff attorneys, as well as members, elected members of Congress as well. So Barr's position is strikingly concerning, I think. There's also something else that I think we can gather from this, in that this is at the same time that the president is urging members of his own staff and his own administration to ignore subpoenas from House Democrats. Now, the Attorney General of the United States, who is an accomplished attorney, is threatening to not appear before the House Judiciary Committee. And the chairman of that committee, Elijah Cummings, Jerry Nadler, has promised to subpoena the Attorney General if he refuses to come. And it's entirely likely that if he does, the Attorney General will ignore that subpoena also. It'd be very consistent. So we're into a pretty tense political situation, which I think threatens, our whole structure of government. And the fact that the president betrayed his own ignorance of the Constitution by suggesting that he would go to the Supreme Court on the issues of impeachment suggests, obviously, that he doesn't really know what the Constitution says about impeachment. And I think that's very, very significant. I apologize for the phone ringing in the background. That's one of those robocalls that they tell us so much about. The fact that the president really doesn't know what the Constitution says about impeachment is disconcerting, but not surprising. But as I mentioned at the end of our first hour, it seems to me the most concerning aspect of this whole thing is that the president believes that he's going to get the kind of result he wants from the Supreme Court. He believes that he has successfully loaded the court with judges who'll back him up. You may remember that when he declared the national emergency on the southern border, he basically implied the same thing about the Supreme Court. When he, if you remember, he went through that sing-song thing. He said, well, first of all, they'll ask me to do something and I won't do it. And then they'll subpoena me, and I'll ignore the subpoena. And then they'll do this, and then I'll do that. And then ultimately, it's going to end up before the Supreme Court, and there I think we'll get a fair hearing. So it's very obvious that the president believed, when he selected Gorsuch and Kavanaugh for the Supreme Court, he obviously believed that he was making a political choice, not a judicial one. He believed that he was appointing politicians to the court, not committed objective professionals from the bench. He believed that. And he obviously still believes it as he talks about impeachment. And I think that's the scariest part. I mentioned that what I would like to get into in this, our second hour, is a follow-up to that issue, and that is to look at Hamilton's Federalist Number 65, which is one of the Federalist papers that addresses the powers of the Senate. And it's the last one, because he opens 65 by saying the remaining powers that the Constitution allots to the Senate are two. One is the issue of appointing the executive appointing people to office. And the other issue to be covered, Hamilton says, is the judicial character as the trial, as the court for the trial of impeachments. So obviously Hamilton is suggesting that he's dealt with the powers of the Senate already, and the only ones left deal with the issue of appointments and the issue of impeachment. Then he says that the issue of appointments related to the Senate will most likely be discussed in the examination of the court. So all we're left with, as far as the Senate is concerned, Hamilton says, is the issue of the judicial character of the Senate. The one situation where the Senate becomes judge. And that's the issue of impeachment. Hamilton says, and this is directly from Federalist 65, it appeared in New York, in the New York Packet, on March 7th, 1788. So remember, the Federalist Papers started to appear in late September and early October of 1787. It's now early March in 88, and they're up to 65, and we know that they're going to be total of 85. Hamilton writes, "A well-constructed court for the trial of impeachments is an object not more to be desired than difficult to be obtained in a government wholly elective." Beautifully written sentence. Basically, what Hamilton is saying is that it's very, very difficult but necessary to have a well-constructed court when the issue is impeachment, especially because our government is elected, and because you're dealing with elected officials by the people, it makes the issue of finding an impartial court difficult. The subjects of its jurisdiction, the Senate's, are those offenses which proceed from the misconduct of public men, or in other words, from the abuse or violation of some public trust. So what we're dealing with here is the impeachment of a president for violating the public trust. These violations, he says, are of a nature which may, with peculiar propriety, be denominated political, as they relate chiefly to injuries done immediately to the society itself. In other words, in the first two sentences of this leading paragraph, Hamilton is making it very clear that impeachment arises because an elected official has violated the public trust. And then he emphasizes, in fact, he puts in capitals, the fact that impeachment is a political process, not a legal one. We've mentioned this before more than once. It is a political process. The prosecution of these violators, then, Hamilton says, for this reason, will seldom fail to agitate the passions of the whole community and to divide it into parties more or less friendly or inimical to the accused. Because impeachment is a political offense, and it's an offense that has brought about the potential removal from office of an elected official, Hamilton says it's naturally going to happen, that there are going to be a lot of people who support the accused and a lot of people who are opposed to the accused. In other words, impeachment is going to increase the threat of parties, of interest groups. It's going to divide society. It's going to divide the general public into supporters and opponents. And as a political issue, that's to be expected. In many cases, Hamilton says, it will connect itself with pre-existing factions and will enlist all their animosities, partialities, influence, and interest on one side or the other. In some cases, there'll always be the greatest danger that the decision will be regulated more by the comparative strength of parties than by the real demonstrations of innocent or guilt. In other words, the danger that a popular government faces in impeachment is that it's going to so divide society that actually the power of the groups, the parties or factions created, eventually could have more impact on the outcome than the guilt or innocence of the official being charged. In other words, impeachment is a dangerous business. It's a dangerous business because it promises to split society into two factions, and the issues become so heated and so emotional that it may be a process that we want to think twice before we undertake. I think all of this is evident at the very beginning of Federalist Number 65. In this kind of a politically charged atmosphere, then, Hamilton is arguing, the convention faced the issue of, given this potential for division in society, who do you get to judge it? He says, and this is the next paragraph, the delicacy and magnitude of a trust which so deeply concerns the political reputation and existence of every man engaged in the administration of public affairs speak for themselves. This issue is huge because it's so potentially explosive. The difficulty of placing it rightly in a government resting entirely on the basis of elections will as readily be perceived when it is considered that the most conspicuous characters in it, from that circumstance will be too often the leaders or the tools of the most cunning or the most numerous faction. On this account, they can hardly be expected to possess the kind of neutrality which is the subject of such scrutiny. Impeachment is an issue which so threatens the peace and unity of the society at large that it becomes harder and harder to find people who can be objective enough to render a decision after a trial is held. This is what the convention had to deal with, Hamilton says. The convention, it appears, thought the Senate the most fit depository for this important trust. Those who can best discern the intrinsic difficulty of the thing will be least hasty in condemning that opinion and will be most inclined to allow due weights to the arguments which produced it. In other words, it's very obvious, then, Hamilton says, that based on those concerns, the threat that this political exercise would so divide society that the result would be worse than the potential good, in a sense. The convention finally resolved, Hamilton says, that the Senate would be the best place to put this responsibility. And what he says is that those people who can appreciate the threat, the importance, the significance, the danger that the convention faced will at least listen reasonably to the arguments they made in support of the Senate to do this. What, it may be asked, Hamilton says, is the true spirit of the institution itself, the Senate? Is it not designed, not just the Senate, the whole Congress, isn't it designed as a method of natural inquest into the conduct of public men? Isn't that what Congress is about? Is inquiring into the character of its members, of public people, people elected to public office. If this is truly the design of it, Hamilton says, who can so properly be the inquisitors for the nation as the representatives of the nation themselves? In other words, the convention knew just what it was doing. It went to the House for impeachment. In other words, it would be the House that would conduct the trial for impeachment, and it would be the Senate who judges it. He says, it is not disputed that the power of originating the inquiry be given to one branch of the legislative body. Doesn't it make equal sense to rely on the other branch of that body to share in the inquiry? The model for this is Great Britain. In Great Britain, the House of Commons is where impeachment happens. The House of Lords decides on it. Several of the state constitutions are set up the same way. They followed the same example. Why wouldn't the Constitutional Convention? And then he closes this paragraph with a phrase that I wanted to share with you because I think it's really powerful. Impeachment, he says, is a bridle in the hands of the legislative body upon the executive servants of government. Think of the idea of a bridle. You're riding a horse, and the bridle enables you to steer the horse, to command the horse one way or the other. That's, Hamilton says, what the legislature does as far as executive branch servants of government. That's what the branch is about. Where else then than the Senate could be found a tribunal sufficiently dignified, sufficiently independent? What other body would likely have the confidence in its own situation to preserve the kind of impartiality between the individual being accused and the representatives of the people, his accusers, than the Senate? It seems, Hamilton believes, that the convention did a masterful job when it came to the issue of impeachment. They put it in exactly the place where it needed to be. The representatives of the people make the case. The Senate adjudicates it. Now he approaches the question, what about the Supreme Court? He says, could the Supreme Court have been relied upon as answering this description? That's doubtful, Hamilton believes. It's doubtful whether members of that tribunal, the Supreme Court, would be endowed with so eminent a portion of fortitude as would be called for in the execution of so difficult a task. And it's even more to be doubted whether they would possess the kind of credit and authority from the general public that those who judge it will need. In other words, because the members of the Supreme Court are appointed rather than elected by the people, one result of impeachment that has to happen, given the divisions in society that impeachment creates, one result is that whoever decides it is going to have credibility with the people. They're going to have to sell the decision. The court, because it's appointed, doesn't have that kind of public trust that the Senate has. Because it's part of Congress, because it's closer to the people, then the Senate is better positioned to sell the decision or to justify the decision to the general public. And given the divisions in society that impeachment causes, that has to be done. Whoever judges it has to be able to convince the people that the decision was the right one. And that's one disadvantage of having the Supreme Court be the judge in impeachment. Also, you would have to have a court, a person judging impeachment with a significant number of members. It would have to be numerous for trying impeachments. You couldn't have a small group doing it. You had to have a larger group than what you'd find on the Supreme Court. Also, you can't be tied down by such strict rules that the courts function under. In other words, it's got to be a little bit more flexible than the legal issues under which the court is forced to function. The conclusion, Hamilton says, is that the Supreme Court would have been an improper substitute for the Senate. Then he says there's yet another consideration here. And that is the issue of double jeopardy. And this is important because this has come up recently on the issue of impeachment. And that is that after having been removed from office, the person removed will still be liable to prosecution and punishment in the ordinary course of the law. In other words, impeachment from office is not the only punishment that a violator of the public trust receives. That person could not only lose his job, but he could also be indicted and jailed for the offense, depending on what it was. If that's true, then if the person is going to be tried again in court for the same thing that got him impeached, then would you want a situation where the Supreme Court, which might ultimately be the final judge of the court case, also is the judge of the case when it resulted in his removal from office? In other words, it would be a case of double jeopardy. The same judge would be making the decision twice about the same crime and the same person who theoretically committed it. He says that error in the first instance would be the parent of error in the second instance as well. Also, there's the issue of impartiality to consider here. Then he raises another question. This is toward the end of 65. What about having the trial of impeachments decided by people wholly separated from other parts of government? In other words, what about finding people who aren't elected officials at all, who don't hold an official position with government? That presents, Hamilton says, a separate set of problems. Where do you find people who'll be objective and fair in a society which has been split in half over the impeachment question itself? If the impeachment issue is dividing society into two groups, then where are you going to find impartial people? So all things being put together, Hamilton says, the decision that the Senate made was the right one. They are the perfect body to make the final determination of guilt or innocence in the issue of impeachment. And then Hamilton closes number 65. And says, which I think is significant, however you feel about this issue, you shouldn't, on the basis of this, go against the whole Constitution and refuse to ratify it. In other words, the Federalist Papers are 85 papers written to persuade the voters of New York to vote for the Constitution by electing Federalists to ratify it, by putting pressure on states in their ratifying conventions, special conventions, conventions of the people, to ratify it. The purpose of the Federalist Papers is to sell the general public on the Constitution. And therefore, Hamilton closes his argument in 65 by saying to the people, however you feel about the, whether you think the Senate is the right person to judge it or not, you don't want to not approve the Constitution because of that alone. He said, basically, it will not follow that the Constitution for this reason ought to be rejected. If mankind were to resolve to agree in no institution of government until every part of it had been adjusted until it became perfect, society would become the scene of anarchy. You're never going to get a perfect system. And if you don't like this part, that part, or another part, it shouldn't dissuade you from recognizing the overall need of the Constitution. It's essentially the same point that Benjamin Franklin made in his closing address to the Constitutional Convention in September of 1787. All of us can find something in the Constitution we'd like to change. But the fact of the matter is, you got to realize that if you wait until the thing becomes perfect from front to beginning to end, we'll never get a constitution. And if we don't get a constitution, we will have anarchy. Who will undertake to unite the discordant opinions of a whole community in the same judgment of it? To answer the purpose of the adversaries of the Constitution, they ought to prove not merely that particular provisions in it are not the best which might have been imagined, but that the whole plan upon the whole plan itself is bad and pernicious. So even if you disagree with the convention's decision to have the Senate judge trials of impeachment, even if you disagree and think that somebody else other than the Senate should be the judge, that alone is not enough reason to vote down the Constitution of the United States, because the alternative will be chaos. That's Federalist number 65. Why did I think, or do I think, that 65 is so relevant in what we've been talking about today? A couple of reasons. First of all, in number 65, Hamilton makes very clear what the process for impeachment is and why it was decided that it would be that way. He specifically rejects the Supreme Court as being a participant in impeachment at all, except for the fact that the Chief Justice will preside over the Senate when it makes the determination on guilt or innocence on impeachment. That's the only concession that the framers made to putting the Supreme Court in this particular process. So when the president says that he'll go to the court to fight the subpoenas, it indicates that he really isn't clear on what the law is in this particular situation. So I think that is important. The other thing that I think is important about 65 is that the framers' major reason, major justification for the Senate as judge is the issue of impartiality. The people will not be impartial because they're going to be caught up in the political divisions that impeachment creates. All the supporters of the accused are going to line up on one side, and all the detractors of the accused are going to line up on the other side. And because the issue is so emotional and so heated, it's not going to be possible to find impartial people. The closest you can come are members of the Senate, because the very nature of their positions puts them in the position of making inquiry into the character and behavior of public servants. That's what they're about, and they're the ones that ought to do it. The Senate is too small. The Supreme Court is too small. It doesn't have the communication or the contact with the general public that the Senate has, and that will be necessary in this kind of a situation in order to justify the final decision to the people. Because you can't let the situation continue to fester by not selling to the general population the idea that the decision was a right one. It's a pretty important point, and it speaks, I think, to many of the issues that confront us today. And I think that they will continue to confront us, unfortunately. I wanted to deal with that. I also wanted to deal with one other issue, and I'm not sure we probably don't have time for it. But it's the issue of consolidation. The charge by anti-federalists about the Constitution that it's in effect creating a strong national government over the states, and that over time, the president, the executive, is going to become stronger and stronger, and that there will come a time eventually when the states won't matter anymore, so consequently they'll be abolished. Many anti-federalists charged that the end game of the Constitution supporters was to destroy the states. And that was a charge that Madison and the other supporters of the Constitution felt they had to deal with, and they did. But no sooner did the new government begin with the election of Washington and the swearing in of the first Congress than Alexander Hamilton issued a series of reports to Congress on developing the economy of the nation and the impact of Hamilton's program, the financial recommendations that Hamilton made, immediately began to split Congress apart. Ultimately, it split the whole nation apart and produced a second political party in this country. The major opponent of Hamilton's program was James Madison, congressman from Virginia. He's the one, along with John Beckley, Secretary of Congress, that organized the opposition that ultimately became the Jeffersonian Democrat-Republican Party. In 1791, let me give you the exact date. December 3rd, 1791, Madison wrote a paper in the National Gazette on the issue of consolidation, the issue of the idea of an overbearing executive, the idea that Hamilton's program indicated a platform, indicated a strategy, which was designed to make the executive branch of government stronger and stronger, to the point that the states would ultimately be abolished, and that we'll only have one government, one legislature, one president. Madison set out in 1791, December, to address this issue of consolidation. We've only got about 2 minutes left in our program today, and I don't think that I can totally deal with it, although I can introduce it, in a sense, with the idea that we can revisit it in our next time that we get together. One of the reasons that Madison's paper on consolidation is so important is because in this paper, Madison lays out the Constitution's strategy for the constant, continual interaction between the states and the federal government, which produce what we call federalism in our political system. For those that have taken political science, have studied the government, you may know that federalism is the whole idea that some powers are specifically given to the federal government, the central government, under the Constitution. Other powers are reserved to the states. The 10th Amendment to the Bill of Rights, to the Constitution, basically says that all powers not given to the central government or reserved or denied from the states belong to the states. So this issue is very, very important. I think this one of the role of the states in the whole constitutional system is one that too few of us really appreciate or understand. This particular paper that Madison writes on consolidation does more, I think, to clarify the complexity of our federal system than anything I've ever read. And that's why I think it's important that we deal with it. But we've reached the top of the hour. So let me say thank you. I hope you have a wonderful rest of this Monday. And if all things work out tomorrow, hopefully we'll be back together again. For Bob Kincaid and Agnes at Head On, this is Bill O'Brien thanking you for your continued support. We really appreciate it. Have a great day.